Hello and welcome to episode 14 of On the Bench. If you build aircraft, ships, armor, automotive, science fiction, figures, or space, this is the podcast for you. In this episode, we're going to be joined by special guest Seth, who will be our subject matter expert on all things plastic in the Star Wars universe, as well as that, our usual segment on what's new, and of course, we're joined by Ian. On the Bench is available on iTunes, and now we're also available on Stitcher. So go right ahead to your favourite podcast app and mark us down as your favourite so you don't miss any episodes. So hello and welcome, and we have our usual co-host Ian. G'day Ian.
G'day Dave, how are you going?
Yeah, good thanks mate. And special guest we have in the studio today, Seth.
Hi guys, how are you?
Yeah, good mate.
We've dragged Seth in from a galaxy far, far away to talk about Star Wars later on.
Yes.
So guys, what's been happening in the last couple of weeks? What have you been up to, Ian?
Oh, well, besides sweltering in this nice Australian heatwave we've got at the moment, finally finished off the Westland Woven.
Yep.
Came up all right, quite happy with it. Yeah, it went together quite well, and paint job turned out nice, so yeah, very happy with it.
Now, it was a Trumpeter kit?
Correct, yeah, the Trumpeter 48 scale.
Yeah, and the pictures look fantastic, and I'll post them to our Facebook page, actually.
Yeah, yeah,
they
all
look
right.
Awesome.
No worries.
Seth, what have you been doing?
Not a great deal, unfortunately, with same thing, but the heat, haven't really been too enthusiastic to go out and do the modelling. Plus also with Christmas and everything, you've been a bit busy, but hopefully that'll change soon.
Yeah, we've been struggling really with this heat wave we've had.
Oh, yeah.
Yesterday was day two of 40 plus degrees Celsius.
Yep.
And, you know, our listeners over in Europe and North America must be rolling around the fall laughing at that, because they've been going through a real cold snap.
Exactly, exactly. Polar opposites, mate.
Yeah, but I'll tell you what, you can't do any modelling when it's 40 degrees plus unless you've got some really good air conditioning in your house.
That's too
sure.
True, mate, too true.
Exactly.
Well, like I say, I haven't been doing much either. I picked up a really good book, which I'll have a chat about later on in What's New. No modelling though. I'm still waiting for my house to get built, and we're at frame stage now. So,
oh, that's good.
I reckon April I'll be in, so I'll get my build room all set up and start rolling. I've got so many projects sitting there just screaming to be built. So
you'll be a busy boy, mate.
I will be a busy boy. All right, so we might move right forward and have a look at what's new, and we'll see what's happening in the modelling world, and also I'll quickly talk about that book, and you've got a book as well that you've brought in.
Yes.
To have a look at as well, so
that's
we'll
right.
Have a quick
yep.
Chat about that.
Sounds good.
All right, coming up shortly. And welcome back to our usual segment on what's new. First of all, I've got a book that I bought recently from Naval Institute Press, and it's titled The British Pacific Fleet, the Royal Navy's Most Powerful Strike Force. And it goes on to detail the British Pacific Fleet that joined the US fleet in going and helping the US carry the war to Japan. So it says on the back cover here, in August 1944, the British Pacific Fleet did not exist. 6 months later, it was strong enough to launch air attacks on Japanese territory, and by the end of the war, it constituted the most powerful force in the history of the Royal Navy. Fighting its professional equals alongside the US Navy in the thick of action. How this was achieved by a nation nearing exhaustion after 5 years of conflict is a story of epic proportions in which ingenuity, diplomacy, and dogged persistence all played a part. And it's a really fine book, and it really details the challenges that faced the Royal Navy in going ahead and supporting the US attack into Japan and the home islands. the logistical side of things, the logistical train was just absolutely huge, and they had to bring so much stuff across into Australia and use Australia as a, like a launching platform to sort of go and then help the fleet. But even that, because Australia's, you know, thousands and thousands of miles south of where the actual Japanese or the fight was. So it's quite an incredible story, and it just goes to show what a military force can do once they sort of put their mind to it. So it's a great read. Thoroughly recommend it. The author is David Hobbs. That's spelled H-O-B-B-S. And have a look around. And as I said, this is printed by the Naval Institute Press, so I'm quite sure it'd be readily available. Yeah, and what have you got?
Yeah, I recently picked up an interesting little publication from Big Sky Publishing. It's called Pioneers of Australian Armour in the Great War. This book's written by David Finlayson and Michael Cecil. And it basically goes, it's basically just a nice little book on the beginnings of the Australian Armour Corps, starting off with the light car patrols in the Middle East and going up to our first tank battalion.
Wow. So that'll fit nicely with your project you've got with
The LCP, the LCP, Model T I'm building next.
Yep. It's a really sort of one of those books that, you know.
Niche book.
A niche book for sure.
Yeah.
So where'd you end up getting that from?
I ended up getting that through the book depository.
Okay. And who publishes it?
It's published by Big Sky Publications.
Yeah.
Get most of my books through the book depository. Good prices, free shipping.
I've got to say, I reckon my book collection or my library matches or is even greater than my stash, because you get all these books, you go, you get sent off on the tangent, I wonder how they did that, and so you go and buy another book and how they did that.
And all your reference material.
Yeah. And I've got to say, I'm not one for electronic books when it comes to sort of this military subjects. I like to have it sort of in paper in my hand.
I'm just not keen on electronic books at all.
Also, in what's new, Drew Savage dropped us a line on our Facebook page, and Drew writes, "Afternoon, gents." He's from California, so g'day, Drew.
Yeah, Drew.
Drew said that he's heard the Hobby Boss is releasing a 1/18th scale AV-8B Harrier 2 this year, and it'd be great to hear your thoughts on this kit and the overall viability of such a large-scale kit. He's wondering if they can get enough details via the injection molding, and does it simply become a mechanism for massive aftermarket items that to add on to what would undoubtedly be an expensive kit. Hoping you haven't addressed this already, and he's into episode, he's one episode behind right now, and thanks. Well, thanks, Drew. So, yes, we have had a segment on or a discussion on large-scale kits.
Yep.
And I did have a hunt around, and Hobby Boss are indeed releasing a 1/18th scale Harrier due for release this year, I think. So
that'd be huge.
It would be huge, wouldn't it? You're almost getting to the point where you could put a model jet engine in it.
I think they call that Barbie scale. You put your action figures in the seat.
As for aftermarket stuff, yeah, I mean, sure, it's really going to push the price up. I mean, we know from Hong Kong Hobbies with their HK Hobbies with their B-17 release, there was a lot of aftermarket stuff.
Yep.
That was made available for that kit, and that really sort of punched the price up if you wanted to buy the aftermarket stuff, of course.
Well, that's right, yeah.
But
well, it all depends how far you want to go with your detailing.
Yeah. And you know, I was reading where one guy had a build, he detailed the build of his B-17, and he bought, you know, $100 worth of stuff. He put it all inside, and once it's all buttoned up, he says, you can't see nothing,
yeah.
So, but yeah, with the bigger kits, you certainly get the more detailed, aren't you?
Yeah. Oh, definitely.
Yeah, it really stands out. And this sort of kit, 1/18th scale, I mean, man, that'd be huge.
That'd be huge. It'd take up a fair bit of paint too.
Yeah, as well.
You'd go through a few pots of paint, painting that sucker.
Yeah. So we'll keep our eye open for more information on that. And when we find it, Drew, we'll let you as well as the rest of the listeners know. So what else is new in the world? Well, at the moment, where the Nuremberg Toy Store toy show is on at the moment.
Oh, the Toy Fair.
Yeah, Toy Fair as we speak.
Oh, is it?
So I've been seeing a couple of early items come through on Facebook. So hopefully we'll have some more information on releases that we'll be able to let you guys know about in our next episode. But as we record this, the show's only just opened, so we'll stay tuned for some more. So what else is happening out in the world there? Looks like Takeom of releasing another German armor kit at the moment, the Bergpanther, which is a what if, I guess?
No.
No? I've never seen one of these.
It's a recovery
before.
Vehicle.
Ah, so based on the Panther chassis?
Yes.
Oh, okay. And that looks like it's going to be, it's just a photo of the 3D print, so we'll wait to see some more information on that and when it comes out. The scale is going to be 1/35th scale.
Yep.
And that's about all we've got for information on
not
that.
A bad looking, not a bad looking vehicle, though.
Yeah, it'd be, look good for a diorama, wouldn't it?
Oh, definitely.
Now, let's see what else is happening around the world. And news from Barracuda Studios. They've announced their New Year's resin releases in 1/72nd and 1/48 and 1/32nd scale. Looks like a whole bunch of sets to fit the new Revell Spitfire, the Edouard FW190 in 48th scale, and the 72nd and 48th scale P36. So that'll be a great boon to the aftermarket crowd.
And also notice they're also for the P40BC in RAF Tomahawks.
Oh, lovely.
That'd be pretty good. Get you to detail up your little Airfix 48 scale P40s.
Yeah.
And I've got a few of the Barracuda sets at home. And
have you?
They're really nice. He does a really good job with those.
Oh, terrific. So what else have we got to talk about? Alpine models, Alpine miniatures. They're doing a second bust in 1/16 scale of a US paratrooper. So for those, we've yet to have somebody talk about
figure painting. Yeah.
So we've got to get somebody in for that.
One of the next episodes, I gather.
Yeah. So it's definitely something that we need to get somebody in the studio to have a talk about. There's this really amazing book that's being released. It's called The Red Army on Parade, 1917-1945. It says 100 years of Soviet and military parades from Canfauna Publishing. So basically it's a whole heap of photos in the book that covers an amazing series of parades that the Red Army put on. And they're always spectacular, aren't they?
Oh, yeah, definitely. And I know how to put on a show.
And I guess this is just a historical photo essay of all the different parades, which shows all the different equipment and everything. But you're right, they certainly know how to put on a show, don't they?
Oh, yeah.
Takeom also announced that they've released a painting guide for the FV-432, which is a British APC. And looks like a painting guide for the Berlin Brigade. So that's where they had that funny sort of different style of, it was almost the early sort of digital sort of
The block pattern camouflage.
Yeah, that's what I'm looking for. So that'll be really nice. And finally, in what's new, AK Interactive have released several new magazines for the month of January. Now, they're pumping out magazines left, right and centre, aren't they?
They do, yeah. They're not bad publications either. Yeah. Good hints and tips.
Hard to come by, the magazines?
No, not really.
Yeah.
I always usually pre-order them through B&A Model World.
Ah, okay. So the two new magazines have got Damaged, which is, they've published that before, haven't they?
Yeah,
so
that's issue 3 that's coming out.
And Little Warriors, tanks in 1/72nd scale vehicles. So let's scroll down to have a look at their Damaged magazine. And is, well, that's, works out well. Because we're going to be talking about this later on. So introduce you to the third issue of Damage, the magazine that has surprised many models with careful layout and great photos. So basically this talks about
Just weathering,
stuff
and
like
doing,
that.
And basically doing it like damage and so forth on, yep, on your kits.
So they've got a Star Wars AT-AT, is that right way of pronouncing it?
It's either AT-AT or AT-AT, depending on
where you're from.
There's a bit of discussion in that in the Star Wars community about the correct pronunciation of that. I prefer AT-AT myself. But,
yeah, I'll go for a slang.
Yeah.
So I've got to get my hand on a copy of one of these magazines because they look quite good.
They are very good. I've got the first two.
Yeah. Pricey?
I think they're about $11 Australian, I think.
Oh, that's not
so
bad.
It's not too bad.
It's not too bad at all.
And they're good advertisement for their own products, by the way.
Yeah,
that's yeah, right. Yeah, absolutely.
Make you want to buy the AK
I've been
stuff.
Collecting all their weathered magazines. Yeah. There's some pretty good stuff in there, yeah.
Yeah, there is.
Get some nice ideas.
All right, well, that's it for What's New. Again, if you've got anything you'd like us to have a look at or you got any information for us, either drop us a line on our Facebook page or you can send us an email to the following address, onthebench64@gmail.com. Next up, we'll be having a chat with Seth about Star Wars models. And we're back and we're talking about Star Wars in this segment. So we've got with us, of course, Seth, who I introduced earlier on. And Seth is our resident expert in Star Wars stuff.
Yep.
Being a Star Wars geek.
That's me.
So Star Wars started, what, the first movie back in 1975?
77.
And I remember going and seeing it and being absolutely blown away, gobsmacked.
Yes.
You see this little sort of spaceship go across the screen. And then this huge one just come across. I'd never seen anything like it before in my life. No.
It was very cutting edge at first time.
Absolutely, it was cutting edge. Just blew me away.
And they were real models back then.
Absolutely, no CGI stuff. So Star Wars models. Where do we start, Seth? Because there's so much stuff out there, and there's good stuff and bad stuff, and
a lot of the old stuff nowadays is like back in the day, back in the '80s and stuff would have been. You know, pretty good, but nowadays you look at it and just go,
why bother?
Look, you're still bothering because, you know, some they're the only ones you can still get for certain chips and stuff, but a lot of the newer stuff is, definitely.
Yes, I remember back in the 80s, I think I built a AT-ST.
Oh, yes, I've built that kit. You can still get that kit
now,
and I can't remember. I've built one.
What brand was that?
It would have been AMT Ertl.
Yes, that's
most
the
of
one,
the old stuff was AMT Ertl stuff.
Yep.
Well, actually, I think it would start off as MPC.
Yes, that's right.
And then they've obviously been bought out by certain companies over the years and been rehashed. Mm. And I think some of them are still reboxed as Rebel stuff now.
Oh, right.
Yeah. So the
first movies that came out were, hang on, let me get this right, episode 4, 5, and 6.
Correct. Yes.
And then they went back and did episode 1, 2, and 3.
Yep.
And then they did Rogue One.
No.
Oh.
No.
Episode 7,
sorry.
Yep.
And then Rogue One came out.
And Rogue One, yeah.
And then they've just released the next one, which is the...
Last Jedi.
The Last Jedi. Mm. And shortly going to be doing another one, which is Han Solo in his younger days.
Yeah, that comes out in May.
Yeah.
So that's not
that's
far
soon.
Away. Yeah, that's soon.
Wow.
Apparently there's a preview coming out probably in the next couple of days for that.
Oh, very exciting. Mm.
Keep me
and there'll be new ships for that too. Brand new Millennium Falcon. It's the early version.
Yep.
We assume we will find out about him winning the Millennium Falcon from Lando. That'll be in the film because there's a young Lando in it as well.
Mm.
And the pictures I've seen online of the Millennium Falcon, has the gap in the middle with the two, what they call mandibles.
Yes.
That's all got like fairing over it.
Oh.
So it's actually like a more of a streamlined looking Millennium Falcon. Yeah. And there's a lot more blue on it. And it's got a different gun on the top. And so it doesn't have the quad barrel. It's only got like a larger single barrel cannon on it. So
So the Millennium Falcon would have to be the most popular kit of all the Star Wars kits that are available and out there.
Yes.
Definitely be one of them.
One of them for sure. Yeah. You can get them in so many different scales and through so many different manufacturers. So let's run through some of the manufacturers, I guess, first of all. But before we do that, I've got to say, and this is a brave move with Seth sitting next to me, and he's probably got his lightsaber in his pocket and he's going to reach out and cleave me in half. But I think the best movie so far is Rogue One.
I agree.
Oh, yep. Wow. There you go. Okay, there we go.
It's especially of the newer ones.
Yes.
It was the old style.
Yeah. You know, fresh, original story.
Yeah, it was original story. It was set during the Empire period that we're all familiar with. Mm. We got to see the same old ships and stuff that we're used to.
Yeah, I thought it was great.
And it was done with the newer technology.
Yeah. I loved it. Absolutely loved
totally
it.
Totally agree.
All right, so different manufacturers. So let's start with Revell. So what are your thoughts on the Revell kits?
They're the more basic ones. A lot of them nowadays are the snap-together pre-painted. So they're more designed for kids, but they do have lights and sound stuff added into them.
But having said that, even though they're still snap-together, they still make quite a good kit though, don't they? In which you can, you know, with a little bit of paint, a little bit of TLC, you can get quite a decent model out of it.
Yeah, because the Bandai ones, which we will get to eventually, I'm assuming as well, they're snapped together and they are, yeah, beautiful.
Yep.
That's
like when we're talking about when I go to model shows and that, and you see the Gunpla guys sitting there. Did I say that right?
I think so. Yeah.
I could never. I don't know.
I think it's Gunpla.
Gunpla. Thank
you. Gundams. So.
Yeah. And you sit there, you see them, and they're doing it, and they're just doing, you know, cutting it off the sprues, bang, whacking together. And the engineering for those kits is really, really refined.
Yeah.
I mean, I'd call it the same level as, say, Tamiya and Wingnut Wings, the way it just fits together.
Yep.
It's just magic. You know, the seams, was hardly any seams in it. And the seams that are in there are designed to be there as a seam as part of the actual kit that is modeling anyway. So.
And they're Bandai kits as well.
Oh, well, there you go.
Most of those are Bandai kits.
So. So the Revell kits, so they do quite a few, and a lot of their stuff is in 1/144th scale and 1/78th scale. And I guess also with the kits, we need to do a distinction. There's the ships, and then there's the kits, which are the figures. So there's sort of two distinct, I don't know, groups, I guess you can call them, if you want to call them that.
Yep.
Probably be more, to be honest.
Yeah. Because
you have the large ships, then you have the fighters.
Yep.
And then you've got things like the AT-ATs and the sort of more armor type things.
Yep, and then your large scale figures you can buy and small scale.
Yep.
Like Knight Models did a whole range of Star Wars miniatures.
Yep.
They were really nice.
And yeah, Bandai make the large scale Stormtroopers.
Yep.
And there were a whole heap. Well, we'll get into the cottage industries later on, but certainly, you know, if you go to Shapeways and that, there's just pages and pages and pages of Star Wars stuff that you can buy there. Not just of, you know, full ships in micro scale or small scale, but also add-ons for the sort of larger scale kits.
Corrections and guns and all that
sort of stuff. So cannons, etc. So Revell's a good starting point, I guess. And I've heard recently they're in a bit of the parent company for Revell's in a bit of financial trouble as well. So
yeah, went into receivership from what
I heard. Yeah, so interesting to see what comes of that.
Apparently Revell have made a statement, I don't know how true it is, that it's not going to affect them at all. They're still running business as usual.
Okay, well, that's good then.
Is there still two Revels? Is there Revell Germany and then Revell USA, which is essentially Monogram?
Yeah, there is, yep. I've never been a big fan of Revell kits. I think that the quality build is pretty poor, and I've never had any success with Revell kits.
I beg to differ.
Okay.
Some of their earlier stuff, it's a bit, but then again, same as Airfix here. Well, you're looking at those early kits from the 70s, from the 70s and so forth, they weren't the greatest of kits.
Yeah.
I think I mentioned a few episodes ago where I built the Revell Schnell boat in 72nd scale. That's a beautiful kit.
Yeah, it is.
That went together like a dream.
That's German Revell, though?
Yes, it was, yes. Yep.
Okay. No, I think a lot of my love-hate relationship Revell comes from
the 70s.
Well, 80s as well.
Yep.
But, you know, even now you still see guys who, you know, post online, you know, they bought a Revell kit and they're putting together and they're going, oh, why did I buy four? I knew it was going to be like this.
Yep.
And it just reinforces my...
because it was cheap.
Well, possibly that's true too. All right, let's get back into the Star Wars stuff. So Revell do a lot of... So Revell have the actual license to build all this sort of stuff?
They do, yes, from Lucasfilm themselves.
Yep.
And with the Bandai stuff, that is mainly licensed for Japan only. And then they used to be able to sell the kits online to like Australia and America and places, but Lucasfilm intervened and said, no, you're not allowed to. Because Revell are their distributor in the US. So
how would people get them then?
People, I don't know if that's been changed now because you can buy them online still, but I know I used to get them from HobbyLink Japan and they're around $20-$25 for like a fighter type thing.
Yeah, that's not a bad price.
And they were a good price, but nowadays they've gone up to, they've doubled in price at least.
Really?
And they're a lot more expensive to get now. But so I don't know if people are... doing it illegally or they're just, yeah.
Or just having to fling a few extra dollars towards Lucasfilms.
Or circumventing the trade sanctions.
Yes. Yes. I know some of the Chinese websites do offer them for sale. Yeah. So, but I don't think HobbyLink Japan, who I used to get them from, can sell them still.
Right.
So it's a bit of a shame.
You've got
to pay more for something you used to be able to get relatively
cheaply.
And good kits.
So we've mentioned Bandai, so let's go and have a look at some of their stuff. And they produce some fantastic kits, some real crackers, don't they?
Yeah, I was a bit sceptical when they first took over because before that, Fine Molds had the Japanese market and they built some great kits and built a couple of those. And when Bandai came out and I heard they were snapped together and they had stickers and stuff like that, I thought, oh, they're going for the kiddie market like Revell seemed to have done.
Yeah.
But I was quite surprised when I've... bought them, and they do have the option of either a decal or a sticker. So,
oh, that's good.
Yeah. So
the biggest stuff that Bandai do is from episode 4, 5, and 6, which a lot of the or the TIE fighters and the X-wings are in 172nd scale. The AT-ST they produce in 148 scale.
48 scale snow speeder as well.
Yeah, 48 scale snow speeder. A Y wing in 72nd scale. A wing in 172nd scale. The AT-AT is in 144th scale. That'd be a huge kit.
Yeah.
I'm still waiting for that Tamiya 35th scale one.
Dragon.
It was spoke about a few years ago, but we haven't seen yet.
Yeah.
And I'm still waiting for the Bandai's massive Star Destroyer that they, when they first announced they were doing Star Wars, they had one that was about a meter long or something on their display stand, but it's so far hasn't seen daylight yet.
I think the cost of something like that would be pretty astronomical.
Yeah. But we'll talk about Star Destroyers in a minute because there's quite a few different companies out there sort of doing it. So Bandai also do the Millennium Falcon in 172nd scale, which I think would be still make a large kit in 172nd scale, wouldn't it?
Yeah, it'd be huge.
It'd be huge.
And apparently it's very well detailed, isn't it?
Yeah, that's, I think, modelled off the one of the studio set pieces.
Oh, right.
One of the big 5 foot one.
Yeah,
wow.
That'd make a great looking kit, I think.
Yeah, definitely.
Also, in the Force Awakens, Bandai do in 144th scale, sorry, 144th scale, they do Millennium Falcon. In 72nd scale, they've got X-Wing Fighter, First Order TIE Fighter, and First Order Special Forces TIE Fighter.
What's the difference?
I don't know. Seth?
The Special Forces one is a two-seater one. And it has extra antennas and guns. That's the one that Poe and Finn escaped in.
Oh, right. Yes.
Okay.
And so it's got extra.
Yep.
I think they've got a hyperdrive as well.
Right.
And, of course, you got Poe's X-Wing fighter as well, which is significantly different from the old X-Wing fighters that I remember.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
In Rogue One, Bandai produce... a 172nd striker, TIE striker, I should say, And they also do an interesting little thing. They've got a special kit where they sell the 172nd scale and the 144th scale Red Squadron X-Wing Starfighter. So I think what that is so you can get like two together and one looks like it's sort of further away.
Perspective. Yeah.
Yes. Yep. They also do in 144th scale a U-Wing fighter and a TIE strike fighter.
And it also comes with the little tank things as well.
Oh, it does too.
Oh, yeah, denim. Yeah. What are those little tank things?
Well, they were supposed to be a tank, but they're not really. They're more like a utility type vehicle.
Personnel carrier.
Yeah, yeah, because they don't really have any massive guns on them or anything.
No. Yeah.
And they're pretty easily taken out too.
Yeah. All right. Now, can we talk about the Imperial Star Destroyer?
Definitely.
Because when I was researching this and I was looking around for this week's episode, I was so close to actually going and buying one. Look at it, it's so damn cool.
Yep.
And I nearly went, and the only thing that put me off was the fact that I had to go through PayPal, I think it was, and I haven't got a PayPal account, so
right.
It was too much trouble, so I set it up and go and buy it. But, man, it looked good.
Yeah, it's a beautiful kit.
So
what brand's that one?
That'd be the Svezda one, I'd say, or the Revel licensed version that Revel do of it.
So who did it first? Well, did Svezda do it first and then send the molds to Revel and let them do it? Or
I believe so, yeah. Okay. So, yeah. Yeah, yeah. They're the original ones and then the licensing went to Revel for
because Revel does a few ICM kits as well.
Yeah, and they actually had their own Star Destroyer kit that came out earlier as well, which had the lighting for the engines. And it had little parts that clipped out, which made a stand that you could put it on.
Oh, but right, yep.
I assume they're still selling that, but I haven't heard much about it for a while. Right. It wasn't as accurate as the Svezda one.
When I was looking at the Svezda one, it also came with a lighting kit as well that you could purchase. And I think the whole lot, all up, is about like 100 euros or something for the kit as well as the lighting kit that came with it.
All right.
And
what scale is that?
Oh, that's a good question. I think it's something like
1/1200th scale.
I think it's 2000 and something.
Yeah.
2500.
Even that'd make a large kit.
It is. Yeah.
Like I've got the original old MPC Star Destroyer that came out in the 80s from the Empire Strikes Back. And that's about a foot long, maybe a little bit longer than a foot long. And that's, not a very accurate kit.
It's got the basic shape.
It looks like a Star Destroyer, and that's all I cared about.
Yeah.
But if you're going to do this, to do it justice, you'd have to use lights on it.
Oh, definitely. Looking at the photos, yeah, definitely.
But then you'd have to have it in a dark room because you wouldn't see the lighting with the light when the lights are on.
Well, that's a point, I guess. Yeah. But I've went and followed a couple of guys online, had a look at their building of the kits, and they've had no real major issues going with it. They said that the thing fits together quite well. There's no sort of major seam lines to really worry about. The biggest issue, I guess, is drilling all the holes for the fiber optics for the sort of lights to shine through. And that's just, a monotonous thing.
Yeah.
And
exactly.
There's different ways of actually doing that, and we should get... hopefully, in the near future, we'll have somebody on who can talk in more detail about lighting kits because there's a number of different ways you can do the fiber optics and there's different things you got to think about when you're actually putting lights into the kit. You got to worry about whether you've got any bleed through the plastic as well so you can sort of see the light from interior and that's coming out through, say, portholes is where you want the light to come out through. So I think we'll get somebody on and have a chat about that in detail in the future. But... it's something I wouldn't mind having a crack at one day, and I was this close to actually purchasing the kit during the week, as I said. In fact, I didn't have a PayPal account.
Sounds like you've got to open up a PayPal account, mate.
Well, perhaps it's just as well I didn't, because I would have bought, I'll let that one go. Okay, what other brands produce model kits for the Star Wars universe? There's lots of little... cottage industry groups that do it. I know that there's, if you go to, I think it's called Cosmos, and just Googling Cosmos, it brings up a whole heap of Shapeways parts and kits and models that they produce.
Yeah, I often go to a site called Starship Modeler.
Yep.
There's a lot of resource stuff on there. I was having a look at that this morning, and it doesn't look like they've updated their information much from a while, so it's a bit of a shame. But I bought a few things from them.
And I guess the thing that really makes or breaks these models really is the painting side of stuff. So how much of a free hand have you got in you know, putting different paints on the kit as if you're – well, okay. Are there rivet counters in the Star Wars universe?
Definitely. It's modelling. It's you can't escape from rivet counters.
Yeah.
Yeah. Another thing with the Star Wars stuff, and probably any sci-fi, is what colours things are.
Mm.
Yeah.
To me, a Star Destroyer is white, but a lot of people paint them grey because that's what the instructions say. But to me, they look white on film. I prefer to go screen accurate than what – you know,
yep.
Instructions say.
Yep. Says it gets some good reference pictures. Yeah. And
like the TIE fighters, for instance, to me, they're a bluey grey.
Mm.
And I had a good Revel paint that was, to me, was a good colour for it.
Yep.
But a lot of people, yet again, paint them light grey.
Yep.
That's, you know, it's a choice thing.
It is a choice thing. And I dare say from Star Destroyer to Star Destroyer, there'll be slight differences in the paint as there are with different during World War II from aircraft carrier to aircraft carrier. There's exactly. Slight differences in the aircraft sort of paint as well.
Yep.
So
I think with sci-fi stuff, it comes down more to the weathering.
Yeah.
You know, grimy, the one want to make them. And
yep.
Yeah. Especially the Millennium Falcon. That's one of those things. It's
yeah. It's always got to look like a dog.
It's got to be rough. Yep. Yeah.
Yeah.
Unless you do the early version.
Yes. Which we'll find out in a new movie, so we'll be able to see.
Or there's even versions of it earlier than that. So.
Oh, seriously?
Yeah, in one of the prequel movies,
yeah,
you actually see the Millennium Falcon lands at the Senate. Actually, it's one of those little Easter eggs they threw in there, and you actually see it land. It's minor. It's pretty small, but...
So here's a question. Was the Millennium Falcon a one-off, or is it part of a class of ships?
It's a class of freighters.
All right. So... the one you saw in that little Easter egg might not have been...
It may not have been the exact one, and there are different variants as well.
Yeah.
That whether or not they're still considered to be canon these days is another
Yeah, it's debate. All pretty up in the air now, isn't it?
Yeah, yeah. There's different versions where the cockpit's in different areas on the ship and things like that.
Right.
The other thing, too, we haven't really touched on yet is the actual figures. So, and the robots and... the droids. Sorry. I can see Seth reaching for his lightsaber.
Is that the droids you're looking for?
Yes.
The droids. I mean, that's, again, Bandai as well as Revell do them.
Yep.
And
The Bandai ones are great, especially you get the two. You get like a R2-D2 and
yep.
R5-D4, and now they've got BB-8 ones, and you can get R2 and BB-8, and yeah.
Quite simple kits, aren't they?
Yeah, I've got the R2, R5 one, and I've built the R5. I haven't built the R2 yet. Okay. Yeah. But yeah, you can build them. I didn't paint it, so.
Well, you just left it as
a... It comes with the coloured plastic.
Oh, okay.
Again, it's one of those things, it's a choice
yep.
of how you want to do it. So I just did the R5 just to see what it was like.
Yeah.
And that's one of the reasons I haven't done the R2 yet, because I want to do that properly.
Yep.
But yeah, a lot of people, some people just... do that and then just weather them with like pin washers and stuff.
That's not a bad idea.
Hey.
But I heard that one guy that did that, it made the plastic go all soft and crumble.
Oh.
Yeah.
That's not what you want.
No.
Okay, so the other thing too is the AT-AT, the AT-ATs. There's some quite large ones of them floating around as well, aren't there, in different ones. In different scales.
Yeah, and as I said, that dragon one would be nice to see because that's going to be massive if they ever do that. But
now they make the... I don't know what it is about the AT-AT. It makes just such a great diorama, and I've seen it where a guy opposed it had like been left rotting in the jungle or something.
Yeah,
and
yep,
that was a magnificent diorama, absolutely brilliant. And I guess, you know, it really lends itself to... lots of battle scenes that you could use it for as well, or, you know, being damaged and...
Well, I've seen some people do them and build them like as a comic relief.
How so?
Oh, I've seen one do it, built one where there's one's like peeing on.
Yes.
There's another one someone built where there's two AT-ATs coupling.
Yes.
Heresy.
Some people have some weird ideas.
That'd be heresy. So getting back to the figures, so when you're doing, things like the Stormtroopers would be, top of the list for a lot of that sort of stuff. So you can, and you're saying the plastic comes, so you don't really need to paint it at all?
No, I probably wouldn't, if I was especially a Stormtrooper, I probably wouldn't paint it because they have that shiny sheen to them. But you get with the plastic, I mean, that's my modelling skills aren't that great if you were,
Stormtrooper's going to be in fairly pristine condition anyway, because it's like when we're in the army, when we're in out in the field, when we're sort of not in the field, our uniform used to have to be, A1.
Yeah, but obviously they go into combat, so I've seen a lot of weathered ones with covered in mud and stuff, and they look fantastic as well.
Yeah, I guess it depends what sort of scene you're, how you're modelling the actual kit.
On a Starship, well then you're going to be pretty clean. But, but if you're going...
Get a lot of officers running around.
Exactly.
Compared to the forest moon of Endor.
Exactly. Or, the sand trooper from A New Hope. So they were always covered in dirt and sand and stuff.
That's very true. All right. Anything else on Star Wars at all then, Seth? Any sort of final parting words that you want to impart upon the listeners out there?
It's going to be obviously with the more films that are coming out now that Disney seem to be wanting to make a new movie every year. There's going to be newer kits, new different ships, and different stormtroopers and different other characters. So it's going to be continuing to grow. Mm. So it'll be just pretty exciting stuff to come in the future, I think. And we know the old days of the old AMT kits are in the past now. So. I think it's...
Onwards and upwards.
Yes, it's definitely a bright future for Star Wars fans. And I also noticed that some of the, like AK and all them, are actually painting stuff for sci-fi stuff now. So we're now getting things that's becoming a bit more normal. It's not just stuff designed for armor and aircraft and stuff. So
catering for all segments of the market.
Correct. Exactly.
Yeah.
Which is good to see.
And I think sci-fi stuff is probably going to be the future for modeling in some ways. Whereas, as people our age and older, we grew up from World War II fans, and that's where modelling has been for years. So I think interest in that is dying off.
It's funny you should say it, because we've had sort of some interesting discussions on this, and computer games are actually, I think, helping to sort of continue modelling, because you've got World of Tanks, which is chucking huge amounts of money into it, and you've got the manufacturers are copying that, and they're building, what if tanks now from World of Tanks. World of Warships is another one where, you get a lot of sort of people actually want to model the ship that they're, using on the screen. So it's all sort of combining now to sort of come round back to where we were when we were sort of young, where there's a whole heap of models, and instead of just us having movies to inspire us or our imaginations, the generation now, they've got computer games as well as movies to sort of inspire them and want them to go out and build it. So I think it's premature to say this hobby is sort of, slowly dying off, or, I don't think that's happening at all. And in fact, I don't think you'd see manufacturers releasing so many kits and so many aftermarket companies, because this wouldn't be able to survive if the
So now they're just releasing larger scale kits because we're getting older and our eyesight.
For some of us, yeah.
And you're getting a lot more modern, post World War II stuff now, especially from TACOM and Meng and all them. A lot of Russian stuff that's,
absolutely.
It's always been overlooked.
The German stuff's been done to death, but it'll always be done because everyone loves that stuff.
So I think our hobby is miles away from the grave. So I think, in fact, we're going to see another resurgence as next generation comes through. And the other thing too is another sort of good feeder into the hobby has always been the Warhammer stuff. And, guys, your young kids, you go off and buy those kits and paint them and everything, they tend to come back after they've got a mortgage and family.
Because that stuff's not cheap. It's not cheap at all, their stuff. I think, honestly, I believe a lot of their stuff is way overpriced.
Yeah, I I'd agree.
Games Workshop,
yeah.
Really.
Yeah.
Yeah, they've got them by the short and curlies, so to say.
Well, at least they're addicted to polystyrene and not some other sort of substance.
Exactly.
So
yep.
You know what? As far as spending your money, it's not a bad area to spend your
exactly.
money on.
Exactly. So. Yeah, totally agree, mate.
Just got to find room to put it all.
Yes.
Absolutely.
That you do, mate. That you do.
All right, I think that just about wraps up this segment in this particular universe. So I'd like to say thanks to Seth for coming along.
Yeah,
and
thanks, Seth.
Thank you for having me on.
Imparting your knowledge.
Yeah, hopefully I was helpful.
We'll see from the listener feedback.
Yeah.
To our listeners out there, if you've got any questions in regards to what we've been talking about, drop us a line on Facebook or you can send us an email to onthebench64@gmail.com. Ian, any last words for you today?
Just keep on modelling, guys.
Seth?
May the force be with you.
Of course. Okay, guys, thanks very much.
Thank you.